Cool. Hello, everyone. My name is Brian Farnhill, and this session is SharePoint Hosting 101, Where Do I Host My Apps? And so just a little bit of background about myself first. So I'm an independent consultant. I'm based out of Canberra. Yes, Canberra. I am one of the few people who think it's a good place to live. SharePoint Server MVP have been for the last 4 years or so. And as well as being an independent consultant and doing my thing there, I'm also a part-time lecturer for Charles Sturt University, who I believe have got a booth around here somewhere. So teaching a postgraduate course on SharePoint 2013 development as part of the Masters of Software Development. So been a very interesting experience for me. But tonight, not here to talk about me, I'm here to talk about SharePoint and apps and what we could do with them. And to go through that story, I thought we'll put a bit of a narrative on this. So tonight, the story is the three little SharePoint developers and the big bad IT pro. All right, so this is how we're gonna wing this. And bear with me, folks, it gets funnier as we go through, I'm sure. So one day in the office, the manager, he's sitting around, he's planning and not being overly productive as managers tend to do. And he says, you know, he's reading up on this SharePoint app model. You know, apps, we need to do apps. We need to build all the apps we can, get them into the store. Apps, 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 apps. So what he does is he pulls his developers into the room. You know, he explains this theory to them. He says, we're going to build these apps. I want you guys to come up with the ideas and tell me how we can go about building them. So the developers, they go away, they start doing their homework, and they come back. And they realize they have each of the three of them, they have their own ideas about how this app can be built. Right? And they line up with the three different options for how we can host our apps inside of SharePoint 2013. The SharePoint hosted app, the auto hosted app, and the provider hosted app. So the SharePoint hosted app, the first developer, he goes away and you know he hears all about the fact that you know we can run apps off server, we can be remote. And that's new, so it scares him. He hears this option, SharePoint hosted. Well, great, I can keep it on SharePoint. Excellent, he starts looking into that path and he realizes it's got to be all HTML and JavaScript. Lucky for us though, he happens to be a JavaScript guy. He's one of those people who thinks JavaScript counts as a real programming language. But the beauty of the SharePoint hosted app model is that everything is hosted entirely within SharePoint. Right, so all you're doing is creating HTML pages, you're writing JavaScript. Right, you're working with ASPX within the out-of-the-box master pages there. And it all lives inside of your content database. And the beauty of this is that the new REST endpoints and the JavaScript object models have been dramatically expanded with SharePoint 2013. Right? If you've looked at doing client-side development with SharePoint 2010 and tried to mess around with that a little bit, it is a tiny little percentage of the size of the new object models that you can access remotely with SharePoint 2013, both through REST, managed.net APIs, JavaScript APIs, so on. So when he sat down and started planning out this SharePoint hosted app, he's saying JavaScript. I can do all this stuff with JavaScript that I used to have to write on the server to be able to get to these APIs. Things like user profiles, search, workflow, all this stuff that you couldn't really readily access remotely before, you can get to now. But along came the big bad IT pro. And he's wearing a suit, isn't that cool? He says, I'm gonna huff and I'm gonna puff and I'm gonna blow your app away. But nothing was deployed to the server. Right? As opposed to traditional server-side development with SharePoint, where you deploy a WSP, it pushes assets onto the file system. Nothing goes to the file system in this case. We're not deploying directly to the server. We're deploying into the content database. And the benefit of that means that it's all captured by existing backup mechanisms as well. It's just content inside of SharePoint. So we can deliver all this new functionality as an app inside of SharePoint and not have to give consideration to all those extra things like where's it going to live, how's it going to be backed up and restored. JavaScript calls aren't going to adversely affect your performance either because it's all client-side calls. If SharePoint gets too busy, ultimately, it could just ignore it. Right, so we're not going to be bringing the server to a screeching halt by writing JavaScript. So at the end of the day, the big bad IT pro really couldn't say boo about this one. So the SharePoint hosted app was there. But all was not well with the SharePoint app. No, not this this little straw house made of JavaScript. There were a few things that troubled the JavaScript developer, and that JavaScript by its nature is more difficult to maintain than managed code. And I stand by that. There are things that help with that. Things like TypeScript is a good place to start if you haven't looked at it. It is getting better to write more manageable JavaScript, but generally speaking, it's gonna cause you a little bit more of a headache from a dev perspective. But there is also another consideration with SharePoint hosted apps, and this is to do around the upgrade sequence. So say I write version 1.0 of my app. I deploy it off into the App Store and people download it everywhere. And I go and I start working on 1.1 and I publish that out. What actually happens when users say, yes, I want to apply this upgrade, is the app web, where all of your files and your lists exist, actually gets deleted and recreated based on the template. So if you're storing data inside of your app web, every time you go through a new version, it's going to get blown away. So yes, we can do SharePoint hosted apps and we can do things with JavaScript, but if you need to be storing data, you need to be looking outside the app web for where you can store that data too. So that's the SharePoint hosted option. But the second developer, he comes along and he does a little bit of reading and he's decided he loves everything in the cloud. Right? So he looks at Windows Azure. What can we do with that? And he discovers there's this option called auto-hosted. Now what auto-hosted will do is it will let you include a Windows Azure website and a SQL Azure database inside of your app package. So that when the user installs your app, what happens is those components will be automatically provisioned out inside of Windows Azure, and all the trusts between Azure and the SharePoint side are all wired up for you automatically. All right, so this was fantastic, because now the developer could go and use the managed.NET APIs and be able to access SharePoint remotely from there, and he didn't have to worry about hosting. I don't need to, I can just push it wherever I want through Azure there. It's all wired up for me, no additional setup. So it gives you a really, really easy approach to be able to set up some fairly complex scenarios and make it easy for the user to install without having to worry about setting up these remote services or how they're going to communicate to them or anything like that. So the big bad IT pro, he came back, and again, there's still nothing on the server in this case. Right? The auto-hosted stuff is designed to be able to be pushed out to the cloud, so by its very nature, you're not looking to deploy anything onto your SharePoint servers. All of the remote access is done through fully supported APIs. We're not looking to do anything hacky. We're using the managed.NET APIs and can do things from there. And the beauty of this is that you could scale your remote app independently. Right? By being in Windows Azure, if I decide that that service needs to have more hardware, I can just go and scale up my website instance. Right? And so I no longer need to increase the scale of my SharePoint to be able to cater for higher usage of my app. But again, not all was well with this. This was the closest to a stick house I could find, right? But the problem with this app is that it only works in SharePoint Online. Right? Auto-hosted apps are designed for Office 365. At the moment, you can't do an auto-hosted app for on-premise. So the other thing to keep in mind with the auto-hosted option is they're currently not being accepted to the App Store. Right? So if you look at Microsoft's list of criteria for submitting an app into the store, they, at the moment, aren't accepting any auto-hosted ones in there. They're accepting provider-hosted and SharePoint-hosted options. So, a couple of drawbacks to this approach. But along came the third, and he says, the provider-hosted app, this is the model for me. This is the do-it-yourself, bring-everything-in model, and I'm going to build it all from scratch. So I can build it as a completely standalone application. Right? I can run it wherever I want. And the beauty of that is that I'm no longer limited to .NET as a hosting platform. I could go and write a PHP-based extension for SharePoint that integrates just as natively as anything written in .NET. Right, so we're not limited to what's going to run on iOS. It can run on any web server anywhere on its own infrastructure. So communication to SharePoint, it's done through all the same mechanisms as you use with the auto-hosted option. All these remote APIs that have been added into 2013, they're all equally valid for building these apps that are going to run off the server. Right? And it had complete freedom to do whatever it wanted. If you're hosting the app yourself, you can do whatever you want with it. Right? You're not limited to specific APIs or anything like that. It's just, there's your endpoints for SharePoint and off you go. So the big bad IT pro, he's still trying to huff and puff. But again, still nothing being deployed to the server. None of the app models are designed to push things to the server directly. Right? They're designed to create a level of isolation between our apps and SharePoint so that we're no longer tightly bound to what's happening at the server. We're ultimately looking for something that we can say, let's upgrade SharePoint and not necessarily have to give a whole lot of thought to what's going on in the apps. As long as the endpoints that your app is calling are still there, it doesn't matter what version number SharePoint is or how you've compiled things or what's deployed to the server and where things have moved to. It's all about that endpoint communication and being loosely bound. the remote app was able to, you know, directly and transparently integrate with SharePoint. And this is a really important point here, is that through things like the app model and the Chrome controls, the client-side web parts, we're able to create experiences inside of SharePoint where they are hosted remotely, but it becomes transparent to the end user that it's done remotely. Because at the end of the day, if you've got something running off server and you completely break that experience for the user between when they're in SharePoint and when they're in your app, they're not going to like using it. It's going to feel awkward, it's not going to fit in, and it's ultimately going to affect adoption. And ultimately, because all this communication is happening over HTTPS, you know, for the remote case, and it should be, you don't have to use HTTPS for development, but in production, you'd be rather foolish not to. But it's all secure. So the fact that it's remote doesn't mean that we're leaving ourselves open from a security standpoint. We have it all encrypted with certificates, and the communication's fine. But even still, there are drawbacks to this option as well. So the biggest thing with the provider-hosted apps is that you'll put a lot more work in up front to be able to support multi-tenancy. So if you think about the auto-hosted model, whenever you install that app, it automatically creates one instance of your website and one instance of your database. So there's your web services that you're going to talk to. With the provider-hosted model, every installation is pointing back to your remote URL. Now, they'll all come in with appropriate query string parameters and things that you can use to differentiate a call from one site to another, but you need to be able to build the support to completely isolate every single installation there yourself. Right, so you need to get the multi-tenancy aspects of your applications right. The other thing you need to give consideration to here as well is versioning. Now, the thing with deploying to the server, if I need to deploy an update, I deploy it and it goes out. With the app model though, I deploy my update, it goes into the store, it doesn't automatically force that update to be installed everywhere that my app is being used. So take this scenario. Say I've got a provider-hosted app that has components in SharePoint, making JavaScript calls and things like that and referring to my website for its services. If I go and update to version 1.1, I need to make sure that all those calls from version 1.0 are still supported when they start hitting my app remotely, because otherwise they're going to start breaking because users aren't forced to upgrade. They'll get the little icon that says there's an update available, but it is entirely up to them as to when it gets installed. Right? Much the same as with your smartphones, if you're downloading apps there and you see, oh, I've got 3 app updates. You're not obliged to install those. You do so on your own time. The same applies for the SharePoint apps. So there's something else that needs to be considered. But also with this model of being able to run remotely and what we're doing outside of SharePoint is you also need to give consideration to what data you're storing in your app and how that's going to be impacted from a search perspective. Right, so if I've got various bits of information about my organization being stored in my remote app, how is the SharePoint crawler going to get to that data? Can the SharePoint crawler be configured to get to that? All right, so you need to be able to go back into that, give some thought to what role search is going to play in all of this. But at the end of it, those are the 3 options. All right, we have the really basic JavaScript stuff for the SharePoint hosted, which is a great way to get started quickly. We have the auto-hosted option in the middle, ideal for Office 365 and what's happening with the cloud. And lastly, we have the provider-hosted, for those who like a lot of work and a lot of control over what's going on inside their applications. Right? And there's not necessarily a right or wrong option for any kind of app you're building. Right? It's going to vary from app to app, depending on exactly what your objectives are. What is it you're trying to build? You might find that a SharePoint hosted app works really well for the first app idea you come up with, but not so well for the next one. So we need to give consideration to how our choice of hosting is going to affect all of these aspects of our apps and what's going on inside of those. But at the end of the day, all the 3 little SharePoint developers, they went out and they had a big party after they deployed their apps to the store, and they all made 99 cents an app because that's what they decided to charge for it. I'm sure one of them at some point said, let's write an Angry Birds app, but there was much rejoicing, and the big bad IT pro returned to his village in shame, and life went on from there. So, really short session here, just wanted to introduce you guys to the concepts, but a call to action. What do I want you guys to go away from this and do? Show of hands, who's actually installed the 2013 SDK? Everyone who doesn't have your hands up, first thing when you get home next week, go and download it. It's downloaded through the web platform installer into Visual Studio 2012 and also for Visual Studio 2013. And it basically, you can start developing apps right now. And the beauty of doing apps is you don't actually need to have a full SharePoint server to be able to deploy to. My third point here, sign up for Office 365 and create a developer site. All right, so if you're using Office 365 and create a site based on the developer site collection, you can actually deploy from Visual Studio directly to that. Right? You don't need to have SharePoint installed locally. Right? So no more lugging around ridiculously large laptops so you can run all your VMs up. You can do it from any machine that can run Visual Studio and can talk to wherever your SharePoint site is. But spend some time exploring the new app model. Right, so I don't know how many of you guys were in the developer keynote with Coetzee there and talking about getting in and start learning and practicing. This is the opportunity. The app store is there now. It's still reasonably new. There are apps there, but there's a lot of opportunities. So get out there, start developing some of these apps. Start building them, pushing them out there, and start that practice. Get out there and do something. But those are my contact details for anyone who wants to come and harass me online. I enjoy the attention. Brian at brianfarnhill.com, at brianfarnhill on Twitter, or my blog there is blog.brianfarnhill.com. And just before I leave you guys to it, there's some related content, funnily enough, both of my sessions. So I've got a session on tomorrow afternoon where we're going to go into much more detail around this app model. So Alex Burton and I are presenting a session on the app playbook, your guide to publishing a great app. And I've got another session on Thursday. I'm presenting with Henny from K2, talking about building business applications with SharePoint 2013 and K2, specifically around building apps for SharePoint and how they actually built their own apps. So K2 have got some new apps for 2013 that are coming out. In that session, we'll be talking to some of the things they had to do to actually get their apps working on 2013. So I'd hope to see you guys at some of those sessions. As always, the resources are here. Channel 9 and MSDN are really great spots to start for your developers, but TechNet and the Microsoft Virtual Academy as well have plenty of great content. And thank you guys for listening. I hope you enjoy it and have a great TechEd.